Dearly beloved sisters and brothers, once again, Father is greeting you all in the name of Jesus. We now listen to the reflections for the day 153 of our Bible pilgrimage. Today our reflections are on 1st book of Kings, chapters 14 and 15, Psalm number 111 and 2nd Corinthians chapter 4. In chapter 14, verse 4, we read about prophet Ahijah. Old age had made Ahijah blind. Now Jeroboam's wife, pretending to be somebody else, coming to meet the prophet to ask about their son Abijah, who was sick. But the blind man, this prophet, he could see that which people with even good eyesight couldn't see. So we read in verse 6, but when Ahijah heard her coming in the door, he said, "Come in. I know you are Jeroboam's wife. Why are you pretending to be someone else? I have bad news for you." See, she went to know about the sick son, but she was told about God's evaluation of her husband Jeroboam's life and the judgment, you know, pronounced over her or his entire family. At the end, also told about the impending death of the son. So the message of this episode is clear. Jeroboam, you know, who had manipulated religion in his evil purpose of stabilizing his political career, we had seen that yesterday. So that brought disaster of his entire family and nation of Israel also. So sin against the first commandment, it can destroy the family in entirety, especially leading others also into idol worship. So this chapter 14, verse 14, we read, see, Ahijah went on to say to Jeroboam's wife, you know, there, "The Lord is going to place a king over Israel who will put an end to Jeroboam's dynasty." It was actually about King Baasha, who came into power by cheating and killing the members of Jeroboam's family. In chapter 15, we read about that. So a cruel and a bad man's coming to power, a wicked man, one who cheated somebody and killed and coming to the power, you know, that was also used by the Lord to accomplish his plans of justice. So chapter 15, verse 29 and 30. "At once he began killing all the members of Jeroboam's family, in accordance with what the Lord had said through his servant, the prophet Ahijah from Shiloh. All of Jeroboam's family were killed, not one survived. This happened because Jeroboam aroused the anger of the Lord, God of Israel, by the sins that he committed and that he caused Israel to commit." Hallelujah. See, the benefits you get by worshipping the idols will soon disappear, but not before it will take you and your family to the jaws of death. That's a very clear thing. Another thing is, you cannot hide yourself and your sins from the Lord. Everything will be brought to light. God is light. And in him, the chosen ones see the things like prophet Ahijah. He could see things before, you know, it is being said to him by anyone. But the Lord himself showed what's going to happen. It's a beautiful thing. Though the message here is very, very sad and distressful. The entire family is going to be, executed, and the child is going to die. The message is really negative, but still we have a serious warning from the Lord. Hallelujah. What is remaining in this chapter and then in the next chapter is the description of three kings of Judah. See, the pattern is first we have seen a king of Israel, now kings of Judah, again kings of Israel. Then will come, as I said earlier, the description of two prophets, Elijah and Elijah. Again, the same pattern, kings of Israel, kings of Judah. Okay, here, kings of Judah. Of course, first one, King Rehoboam, one who succeeded King Solomon, son of Solomon. Bible says, Judah sinned much during the time of Rehoboam. Their evil included worshipping of the idols in the secluded places, the tolerance of homosexual acts. We find that there were male prostitutes. So, and many other abominations they learned from the nations around. It's no surprise, therefore, to know that how easily Egyptian king Shishak, he invaded Jerusalem and robbing the temple of its treasures and stripping the house built by Solomon, namely, House of Forest of Lebanon, of its 500 shields of fine gold. We had seen that he had made shields of fine gold and displayed it on the walls of the House of Forest of Lebanon. So according to some historians, the approximate calculation they represented is a fortune of not less than $50 million for this stuff of 500 shields of pure gold. These golden shields might have been to Solomon a symbol of divine protection, because the Hebrew word used here is exactly the same word used in God's promise to Abraham, which we read in Genesis chapter 15, verse 1. It's like this: do not be afraid, Abraham. I am your shield, your exceedingly great reward. So, the same word is used here, shield. So he lost it. The enemy has taken away. How they lost their faith. That is the meaning here. So Rehoboam replaced the shields, but not with fine gold, but with copper. And also we find that they did not fill the house of the Forest of Lebanon again, but it was kept in the storeroom, the rooms of the guards, yes, in the guard rooms. Yeah. So there must be a lesson in this for us. Our battles are spiritual and are against the spiritual forces of darkness, the host of wickedness guided by enemy, Satan. That's what we read in Ephesians chapter 6, 12 onwards. So our shields are visible testimony to our faith in a living God who is able to help us, who is able to keep us, who is able to protect us and guard us. So our faith is our shield. Ephesians 6:16. And that shields are taken away by enemy. So the question, are our shields, which are the symbols of our faith in God, are they on display? Or have they been taken away by enemy? Have they been replaced by something inferior, which we keep handy if needed, like this man had kept it hiding, like when it comes handy, we will use it, like keeping in the guard rooms. Our true faith, unadulterated faith and trust in God, might be taken away by evil one. There is a chance if we live in sin and we have replaced these things of eternal value with those of less importance. Very often it happens. Then we are satisfied with the minimum things. We will be deteriorated into a people interested in doing the minimum things. The best thing, our most important thing, that's our true faith, can be lost. The sad thing happened here about Judah is that. Hallelujah. So what is the root cause of this downfall? One thing is here again said, repeated. I don't know whether you have noted that verse 21 and also verse 31. It is written the beginning and in the end of description about Rehoboam. It is that his mother's name was Naamah the Ammonite. She was an Ammonite, a pagan. That is very clearly written. Why it is repeated? Because something is there. That is repeated. After explaining about all this moral and degradation, sinful things increasing, faith lost, enemy came and taken away everything, looted everything, again describing his mother was an Ammonite. Meaning, Solomon's marriage to pagan women actually diluted faith. That is why instead of pure gold, now in the next generation, what is this? Something inferior made of copper. Hallelujah. Now chapter 15 verse 1. Now in the 18th year of King Jeroboam the son of Nebat, Abiam began to reign over Judah. Do not be confused about this 18th year and the new king. 18th year of King Jeroboam in Israel. Here in Judah. So they are connected, scripture is trying to connect them together. That's why we should not be confused. Two kings, two kingdoms. So here in Judah, Abijam, he came. And about him it is written, he lived a wicked life. He also took people away from the Lord. So sin increased in his time also. So we don't go into it. He lived only 3 years and he died. Then the 20th year of Jeroboam, verse 9, king of Israel, Asa began to reign over Judah. So about Asa, the third king, some beautiful things are described. He did some wonderful things. He began well. He was somewhat righteous man. But we will speak about him more when we come to read 2 Chronicles. That time more descriptions are there about the same man. More message we will get, so we will leave him for that time, because by the end of his rule, he had a miserable time. He had done some foolish thing like looting the temple of God and gifted it to a king of Syria, a Syrian king, to get his help actually. Instead of trusting in the Lord, he trusted in human beings, in another king. And thus he sinned against the Lord and he died a painful death. He had a wound in the feet and he died. Word of God says about that more messages we await from 2 Chronicles. Praise the Lord. Now let us come to Psalm number 111, the greatness of God's works. In verse 1, praise the Lord or hallelujah. It's a hallelujah psalm. Begins with hallelujah. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. It's a declaration and decision to give glory and praise to the Lord, which is his due. That's the first thing. Then verses 2 and 3, it's a study of God's great work. Great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who have pleasure in them. So, you have to study the great work. Then verses 4, 5, 6, that is, remembering God's great work. He has caused his wonderful works to be remembered. So remembering God's great work. Then next 7, 8 and 9, they are the nature of God's great work. Work of His hands are faithful and just. All His precepts are trustworthy. You can believe in the work of the Lord and His commandments, His precepts. They are established forever and ever, to be performed with faithfulness and uprightness. All these are nature of God's great work. Then the last two words, verse 10. What should be learned from God's great work? Studying, remembering, learning about God's work, what we get to know, what we get, the message is this, the final message: fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A reverence and love for the Lord, seeing all His work. You start loving, you start having greater reverence. We will never take Him for granted again. So that's called the fear of the Lord. And fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. True wisdom comes with that. A good understanding how all those who practice it, His praise endures forever. Hallelujah. Coming to the fourth chapter of second letter of St. Paul to Corinthians. Actually, this chapter follows Paul's teaching in the previous chapter about the transformation that happens for those who see God's glory in Christ Jesus. Some are blinded to it because of their sin and by God of this world. So they cannot see it, he says. But he knows that he and his co-workers are fragile containers. They are earthen vessels, but they contain the priceless message of God's grace through faith in Jesus Christ. And so the proof of their apostleship is the sufferings that they endure for the sake of the people entrusted to them, like Corinthians. See, in all the chapter, almost all the chapter, he comes back to the same theme of defending the apostleship and authority. And he says, we are like earthen vessels, but we have that grace, the authority that we have received. That is the true message that we carry. Because of that, verse 8, we are afflicted in every way, but we are not crushed. We are perplexed, but we are not driven to despair. We are persecuted, but we are not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying in the body the death of Jesus. Why? See, he is speaking about, this is called, you know, endurance, as I taught you, I told you in the first day when we started with the Corinthians. St. Paul is giving this thing called endurance as the proof of his apostleship. Because by endurance, they will be able to save others who are entrusted to them. So verse 12, so death is at work in us, but life in you. It's for you. Verse 15, for it is all for your sake. It's for your sake that as grace extends to more and more people, it may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. So he says, verse 16, we do not lose heart. Though our outer nature is wasting away, our inner nature is being renewed every day. For the slight momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. Because we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. Beautiful thing. So, that is actually the meaning of endurance by which they will be able to save others. That itself is the proof of their apostleship. Every chosen person will have this endurance for the sake of others. May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.